This is probably going to be the most shoddily prepared diploma presentation ever.
Yeah,
right. I was a bit busy organising my celebration event. and I haven't even talked to my whole group out yet. So I need a couple of volunteers still who are happy to give up the next hour after this one to sit and discuss what you've seen and fill in all these forms. So Jenny and Alan both can handle it.
Is that a bit of random assembly there, Jen?
A bit of random assembly. A bit wild design.
Yeah.
But can I just be clear that we've actually got things that we've actually got a peer group.
So we've now got.
I've just been organising that. If you're on a peer group, can you just stick your hand in?
If you're on a peer group, so we've got Randy Gallery, Jenny, Katie, in front. Selena? Right, so, so what I'm going to talk about is, first of all, hello. My name is Joe Atkinson, and since April 2009, it's been my great privilege to work with the Local Association. I did my PDC back in 2007, and before that I was normal. So, what I'm going to do is, I'm also going to have a very quick overview of my portfolio. I can't get online. All my portfolio is online, so you're welcome to go and have a look at it afterwards, if you can get online. I'm going to do a very quick overview of what's in it, and then I'm going to try somewhat ambitiously to look in more detail at three of the designs that are in it. And offer one or two kind of reflections, some of my reflections on the journey. And then I'll sort of round up with some acknowledgements. Okay, so for international folks, British diploma pretty much requires that you produce 10 designs, and that there's that it demonstrates progression in your ability and learning and stuff. So that means that your first design can be a bit crap, which is so I'm not going to do that. In my portfolio, there were three main kind of themes that emerged because of what was going on in my life of that period. I started the diploma in 2009, shortly after starting work at the association. And at the time, I was also working as a self-employed gardener and doing some garden design and implementation work. So about four of the designers in the diploma are kind of private, suburban-scale gardeners. During that period, I also moved into helped to build and moved into an urban co-housing project in the city where I live. Four of the designs in my diploma relate to that period of kind of development and moving in, taking over the site and developing landscaping there. So that's what we're looking at. And then another key project which kind of came out of my job at the Permaculture Association and was kind of a mixture of my work there and voluntary work was the European Permaculture Teachers Partnership, which was a two-year project which connected lots of teachers from around Europe and helped in some way to kind of galvanise and cohere the European network, I think. So I'm going to look at one design from each of those three key themes. Okay, so Lilac is the name of the co-housing project where I live. It's an acronym, it stands for Low Impact Living Affordable Community. And it's 20 straw bale homes arranged around this central pond, and it's kind of got this innovative financing model called mutual home ownership. But I'm not going to go into any of that because that's a massive kind of tangent. But the point when I got involved in the project, the architect's drawings had already been submitted to planning, and that included the landscape plan. The project took was over in, I'm not going to draw on that too much. So the drawings had already been submitted to planning, so some of the kind of thinking about the overall landscape plan was already in place. These are kind of the things that were going on kind of, in terms of the project itself, and then another set of observations about what's happening in the community at the time. So we had all these surveys done, there was lots of information to draw on. We were committed to achieving this CFSH's Code for Sustainable Homes, which is a kind of voluntary standard that measures how sustainable homes are. So we committed to that. We had had an initial landscape visioning exercise and a member consultation, and that had been conducted with the people who had been members at that point in time of the project. So at that time, there were about, of the 20 homes, about 8 had been filled. So that consultation hadn't been completely inclusive. New people have come along since then. I'll talk about that a little bit later. Some drawings have been produced by the landscape architects. And we'd agreed that the building contractors were going to do the hard landscape, and then we're going to put in the paths, and we were going to do all the planting. And the plan that they produced had promoted stuff like food production and promoting biodiversity, etc. We had £6,000 budget. But yeah, this was kind of key thing for me, is the fact that a lot of new members have got involved, and so they haven't been included in that consultation phase. So some observations about the community. So this is the community enjoying a day out in a wonderful lake. So we had this, at the time we had this organisational structure, which was we had a board of directors legally, but they were called the development group, to soften the language a little bit, and they were kind of a lot of the power and control of decision making was work. Concentrated in this small group, and that was leading to the development group feeling quite starting to get stressed out. A couple of people approaching burnout, and a lot of the other members felt like they weren't being included. So there's a little bit of kind of friction emerging within the community. A lot of people in the landscape plan, some people really understood it, some people didn't even know it existed. There was also a range of skills in terms of gardening. Some people were really keen gardeners, so like Laura here. Really keen gardener. Other people kind of describe themselves as something like black thumbs, you know, it's a plant that dies. So there's kind of diversity on there. Some people were into permaculture, some people didn't really know about it. At the time, there were two PGC followers in the group. And then we have this, in our documents, we have this kind of shared values, which included we're environmentally sustainable and we embrace the society, we have a low carbon lifestyle, and see permaculture as a guiding principle. So when I saw this in this kind of our values document, I was like, ha-ha, brilliant, I've got a mandate to kind of promote permaculture within the group. So that's what I set about doing in a kind of slightly stealthy way. Okay, boundaries. Well, the boundaries around how many resources we have, there's a limited budget, my time, and then there's, all the boundaries of our responsibility. But the resources we had, kind of talked about those skills in the group. And then we had interesting resources like free access to venues to meet and discuss things. And that's the planting plan, it was then. You can't read it, but these are all kind of plant lists that have been suggested. landscape architect. When I really looked at this plan in detail and then looked at the what had come back from the planning office when we got planning permission, I realised that there was quite a lot of flexibility in this plan. So it specified a lot of species, suggested species, like typical species might include, and I was like, brilliant, that's good. So we're not committed to using those particular species. And it also had, these were suggested locations of trees. So it was saying, should be a tree here, etc. It didn't say which tree should go where. So that also meant we could kind of play around the design quite a lot. And there was still quite a lot of work to do. So I realised that we had scope to, at the same time, put a lot of thought into the detail of the design, and in so doing, include a lot of the membership who hadn't been involved in the original consultation or who were sitting outside the development group and currently being a bit excluded. So I wanted to empower people, get people more involved in decision making, things like deciding which tree should go where, probably should get that right first time, but we could play around with a lot of the other stuff, like annuals and biennials and that kind of thing. We could, it didn't matter if they were wrong the first year, because we could, over time, gradually develop the permaculture thinking in the community. So that, they were kind of the key priorities that I can see. And that sort of evolved into a brief, which was, so rather, I wasn't going to design the landscaping, I designed a process that enabled the community to collectively design the landscaping. So that's what this design became. So the brief that I kind of gave myself was to co-create this shared vision that everyone could have to deliver that vision through different designs of different parts of the site, implementation plan, and also lots of learning and skill sharing in amongst all that. Also, building and developing links with the wider community was a really important one. We were conscious that we were kind of plotting a kind of eco neighbourhood in the middle of an existing white working class and so potentially slightly socially conservative area of the city, and it was important that we didn't become seen as a kind of separate enclave that was not connected to its locality, so it's really important to try and invite people in. And then have some fun on the way as well. So my kind of, what started off as these priorities and issues then evolved into this emerging grief, which then I realised could be seen as the functions of the design. So what the actual function is, it's now these things. Power members, credit share vision, blah blah blah. I'm repeating myself a bit more. And these are the elements that I thought we could use to achieve those functions. So create a landscaping team that could make some of these decisions and take some of that take some of the burden and control away from the development group. Have individual area coordinators who would put together the design for specific areas of the site. Events that work to get people involved, so you've got all member consultations. Work days, so actually doing it, making stuff happen on the site. And then this kind of ongoing invitation to learn. And that takes place on a few days. One of which is that there's a regular permaculture design course that happens in Leeds, like a 5-minute walk away from the site, which I teach on. So yeah. I was very keen to avoid the notion of me as the landscape expert becoming entrenched within the community, because I was running this little gardening business, and I was working at the Permaculture Association, and I sort of teach on permaculture courses. I was very conscious that I could be seen. There was a potential that people in the community would think, right, okay, landscaping, we need to ask Joe what to do, and he'll tell us what to do, and he'll read it all. I was really, really keen to make sure that didn't happen, and So I was actively trying to kind of step out as much as possible and get other people to do the work. So the education programme is more about, well, there's these courses going on, if you want to come down, it'd be great to see you, but I'm not going to try and force anyone to do permaculture. So it's like kind of functions and elements matrix to check how multifunctional my elements were and to make sure that my important functions were being supported by certain elements. So we talked about these elements, functions outside. Kind of a kind of bubble design, thinking about what the process might be, like how might I approach this. I was thinking a little bit about patterns at this point as well. So, obviously, I've got this pulse pattern, so I can see these things being kind of recurring actions that would happen at different points throughout the project. And then I think somewhere hidden up at the top behind where it says bubble, I was wondering, is this a linear pattern or is it kind of spiral patterns that come back and repeat, but slightly differently? So that was my initial thoughts. And then I started thinking about zones and communities as well. I was thinking about these existing zones that we had. We had the development group who, at the beginning of the project, they were focused for, they had all the information, they had all the decision making power and all the control. There was them, and I worked with neighbours, etc. And what I wanted to go for was something more like this. So you have the landscape team as the kind of call people holding this landscape design with some liaison with the development group. And then area coordinators sort of in the next zone out. And on reflection, I'm not sure how successful this was at planning zoning community. It was kind of an interesting exercise, but whether zones are a useful metaphor in a macrocultural setting, I'm not sure. It's interesting to explore it, and there might be other areas where it can be applied more successfully. So then I was thinking about placing the elements in zones, and I started. This is a little bit back to kind of a matrix type thing. This is a little bit inspired by database design. I don't know if anyone knows anything about SSADM. It's a kind of whole design methodology for how you map information. And often naming the relationships. So I thought this was quite an interesting way of getting a little more detail about what, it's not just things are in place, but they also have a different relationship that has a kind of functional aspect to it as well. So kind of exploring this stuff. I've got this kind of, this is a schematic of what I ultimately came up with. So this is like bubble design in the formal form. So I've got the elements down the side, so I've got the landscape team, meetings, roles, the area coordinators, design workshops. Then time is going this way. This is like a setup phase before getting access to the site, and this is once we've got on the site and start implementing it. So all these things are kind of things that have to happen in those different phases. So that's the broad color coding of those things. This is like this overall design. I've then done another design for this part of it, so the red area is another design in my portfolio. It's all about how to set up that landscape team and give them a brief and the tools that they need to get them going. Then we had an all-member workshop, which was like how to design and facilitation for that. And then I took on the tree layout design. I was really keen to put some design, some permaculture design thinking into where the trees went to make sure that we got that bit right at the beginning. Hopefully we did. That's another story. So yeah, that's kind of the overall design. You can read all about it later on. And then this is kind of the actual plans, kind of dates and what happens when in those two sort of phases. More detail. initial ones to exceed meetings. So this is getting into implementation of the design, setting up this setting up team. So I'll just put out this invitation to everyone. If you want to join the landscape team, come along to this meeting, you can self-select. And essentially then we just kind of started doing it with just people took on areas and started coordinating them. We have this design workshop, which is design 5 in our portfolio. Wilf will recognise the technique that I've used here, which is an ICA facilitation technique where you get everyone's ideas on board and then pass them into people. It's a really good way of doing a client interview with a client group, several people, so you can get a collective brief. And then start doing it. You might recognise this character here. This is Alan Thornton, who's been the overall IPC coordinator, who also lives at home. And then the education stuff. I offered a one-day introduction just for LILAC members, where we looked at all the kind of stuff, what is benefit, blah, blah, blah. I think only 5 people came. Since then, a few people have done the PVC, so I think since we started off, 2 people have done the PVC, I think since then about another 5 or 6 members have done it. So it's definitely becoming more prevalent in the thinking. And then ongoing maintenance, yeah, people doing maintenance, basically. And then valuation, hardware and ethics. I think the design has empowered the wider community. It certainly took a little bit of pressure off the development group, and people could start to get involved more than they had been. So it relieved some of that frustration that had been building up. Enabled people to share knowledge, enabled people to learn. And then, how do these principles? Some of them, I think, you could probably find a way in which the ones that I left back were also used, but these are the ones that jumped out at me immediately. And I'll do like a little plus minus interesting, what worked in the design, what didn't, what was interesting about it. So this pattern for this design is one that I used for all my design writing. I guess another part of the evaluation is we won an award at the Leeds Architecture Awards. And what's really nice about it is that it kind of says collaboratively designed by the architect and the LILAC residents. So it kind of, it was a real collective effort doing the actual design, that was recognised. And then I kind of done my own kind of reflection on what went really well. These are the 4 questions in the 4 action learning questions. What went well? What was challenging? What are the goals and executable steps? And then I have like a little reflection at the end where I gave myself a little pat on the back, which is I came across this quote, which is a leader is best when people barely know he exists. Of a good leader who talks little, when his work is done, his aim fulfilled, they will say, we did this ourselves. And I love that philosophy of leadership. primarily because I hate being sort of telling people what to do and all that sort of thing. That's not really, this sits quite comfortably with me. And there's a lot I hope to achieve in the design. So just enable everyone to take over and do it themselves. Right? But to kind of just make those few tweaks at the beginning to give people the permission to do it and give them the confidence. So anyway, that's my LILAC design. The next design I want to show you is this one, which is this was a paid job that I did for someone who's a guitar teacher, and they got in touch with me and said I would like some design ideas for our garden. They didn't want me to do a whole implementation, they just wanted some bit of design thinking, and this is very much more like the when I set out on the diploma journey, this is what I imagined I would be doing 10 designs like this, where it's you have a really well-defined client, you have a well-defined brief. You're working as a sort of loan designer and you prepare some drawings and then and it follows a really traditional process. So this is where it is. Cricket fans will have heard of Headingley, which is a big... Headingley is the centre of the world, so Yorkshire cricket people. And the client's house is just south of the ground, so it's there. It's in Leeds in Yorkshire. It's 80 metres elevation. It's this kind of climate, so cool temperature. This is what the garden looked like. So it's a bit of a blank slate. The client wasn't too interested in keeping much. They'd already destroyed most of it. And so, I mean, there wasn't that much happening. It was like, well, you can see what it was. I did a little sort of panoramic photograph. This is the view from the kitchen door, and looking due south. Thinking that it is also one, but you might manage some of it for different reasons that would be. So you might have an area of your garden that you want it to have. You might promote wildlife, so that might be. It's not a zone 5 because it's in the middle of town. But so I was thinking about what about if you have like zone 1.1? So that's kind of the area of your zone 1 where you're going to have. Oh, that's going to be like growing crops and stuff. And then what about a zone 1.2? We grow some fruit trees, but in my zone 1. And then like a zone 1.5 for promoting wildlife. And again, I don't know, is this useful? Is it just like complicating stuff? Oh, it's just something that's my kind of thought about. Bulk design, so a quick sort of sketching out areas. There's no point ripping up the car park, which is over there. So leave that as that. Have some space for play and leisure. But because Seb worked at home, the guitar teacher guy worked at home, and Emma worked in an office, so she'd get home around about between 5:30 and 6 p.m. And that was the only area of the garden that still had the sun on it at that time of the evening, so I thought I'd create just a little seating area so when she gets home she can sit down, have a cup of tea or a glass of wine or whatever, so she could have a little seating area as well. And then stick the wall back in, why not? So that's kind of more detailed design. And then I was getting really excited about this kind of software model. We find all these kind of different textures to the sun. This is just a little note on patterning, really. So all the a branching pattern for how the paths work around the site. And the paths get progressively thinner as they get used less often, so taking up the smallest amount of space for circulation as possible. And then there's kind of a radial pattern here as well, which is the water butts and compost bins kind of sit in the middle of all these paths for the beds. So that the two things that you like to be going to regularly, the water and the compost, they're kind of central. Okay, and then valuation, I think I've been thinking about the ethics as I've been doing it, and then here are the principles that I use the most. And plus that's interesting. The mice mainly were, but it was a bit weird doing design without really thinking about implementation or knowing which of those ideas the client would adopt. And then how to define the process, etc. So that's that one. I'm doing for time. 15, sorry? No. Well, parts of it were, I think, but not all of it. Another interesting thing was that I I charged the client in guitar lessons instead of... Because he charges a lot more for his guitar lessons than I do for design. Okay, so this one is...
Actually, probably
10 minutes.
I'm sorry.
10 minutes. 10 minutes, right. So 10 minutes to present the European Permaculture Teachers Partnership. right, so the Headingley Garden was very much what I consider to be a traditional design process. I think, you know, there are various different perspectives on what design is and how design happens. You know, there are different models about the design process. And the one that the British Diploma tends to be based on is what's called the rational model, which is that there's a logical sequence of steps that a designer goes through to get from, you know, what you want to do to it being done. And then there are contrasting perspectives that say that actually what designers tend to work much more intuitively and they sort of jump around between steps, and in reality it's much messier than that. And I think this is probably an example of one of those slightly more messy designs. At the beginning of this process, I didn't know it was a design. It was just, oh, let's do this, it'd be good. A bit fun, you know, it seems like a good idea. But also, I think it's really worth, I really struggled with this for ages, like, what counts as a design and what doesn't. And is it okay to put in a design that was never really intended as a design in the first place? And actually, I didn't really design it myself. It just came together and did some stuff. And there's a really nice definition of design by David W. Orr, who is like an American academic who writes about ecological design. And his idea of design is that it is, that ecological design is kind of the result of collective human intention. I think that's a really interesting definition of design. It's not like a really kind of focused process that one person goes through, and it's not kind of the sole reserve of kind of experts, but it's kind of what happens when people decide they're going to do something. And I think that's kind of why I think I have permission to do this as a design. But also the fact that the project was really successful, and so I think there's useful learning in it, means that, well, let's have a look at what the process was that emerged, and are there useful things that we can take from that, and that we can synthesize from it and reuse those as useful patterns. So that's why I'm presenting this. So, European Permaculture Teachers. I can't take all the credit for lots of teachers operating permaculture in Europe who were quite isolated. They didn't have very robust support networks around them. And then there were other places in Europe where there were really vibrant teaching communities. And so the need was to support those people who were more isolated. So then there's kind of, so there's this, well, I think there's a need, and then there's kind of, let's investigate it, find out more, what's the detail, what actually is the need. Are we right? Identify who your allies and partners are, and then once you've kind of built your fellowship of people, it's a bit like a hero's journey, once you've built your family of people, then really clarify what your vision is, what you actually want to do, and checking in and making sure everyone wants to come along with it. And then the process of co-design, which is a little bit chaotic, but very rich, and then doing it, and then afterwards evaluating it, and then reflecting on it. So, some of these stages are a bit different to the traditional design cycles. Okay, so the need was, as I've discussed, some people need more support networks around them and didn't have a kind of professional or peer support network on a local or regional or national scale. So if we could create a European level support network, that could enable, it was about accelerating succession really, it could enable those local people to then draw inspiration, share skills and knowledge and experience and build up their own local networks. So this structure should ultimately become obsolete. It's just to kind of promote and accelerate that development.
That's the idea. It came about when this permaculture educators training in Freeland in Denmark, I was on. Cal, you were on. Anne-Marie Brookman, who's here somewhere, not in this room, but has been presenting, she led the course. And some of you have met Sandra as well, who's one of the other coordinators of the RPC. She was also on that course. We had this day out to visit this ecological garden. And the course designers did a really clever thing, which was they made us take three buses to get there and three buses to get back, which meant that it would create all these little kind of two-person conversations. So we kind of we're all getting paired up with different people. And one of those conversations happened to be me and Sandra, and we started talking about, wouldn't it be great if there was kind of more of this sharing going on, and how can we make more stuff like this happen? And the idea was originally to have a European Teachers Convergence, so we have an event that just teachers would come to and share, much more focused sharing than this kind of convergence where it's like anything. At the end of that course we had an open space and we decided, yeah, let's do that. In the meantime, between that course and that Teachers Convergence, I went, trotted off to Belgium, went to the EUPT, did a bit of a survey, asked all these people what kind of stuff should get discussed at this kind of convergence. Make a use of lists like this, so not much. So I wrote this list down, took it to this Teachers Convergence that happened in Germany a couple of years later. Sorry, follow me. Where we got that list and then sort of dot voted to decide which ones were the most important and which ones we could take to the next step. Also at that meeting was Kipper, this gentleman here in green, who had been involved in a European partnership.
Learning partnership.
Yeah. So he kind of explained how you can get loads of money from the EU to do cool stuff. So that's what we decided to do. So we got a load of money from the EU. This is where we found out how does this funding work, what can you do with it, where can you get it from, where can you spend it, yada yada yada, and gradually sort of started to design our network. What was this project going to be? And it's still visioning at this point. It's like, what could we do? We moved into more of a kind of co-design. So this is, thinking about what's the shape of the project going to be, who are the people who most likely to get involved in the pipeline, lots of brainstorming. This is a slightly random picture of a sculpture in Manchester called the Bee of Fang. It's the only nice picture I can find in Manchester. I have to say that's of Yorkshire, I don't mean it. So I went to have a meeting with the funders in Manchester, and at that point that then helped to really move on the kind of the detailed design of the project. I'm running out of time, so I'll just pass you these. Then lots of Skype calls, online collaboration, design the project, and really sort of nailing down what the objectives were. And so this is what we decided we wanted to do. And we're a little bit kind of back to front, because really what we wanted to do was the last one, which is to form a network of European teachers. That's really what the whole point of the project was. And then into the reasons or the things that we wanted that network to achieve. So it's about support teachers in practicing teaching methods and enhancing their teaching quality, exchange about different curriculum course format, blah, blah, blah. Kind of written in funding ease, but essentially it's about upskilling ourselves and creating this kind of learning partnership network thing.
European Convergence in Germany in 2012. And at this point, there were some people who got this funding and didn't really realise what it was all about. We always had these new people coming to meetings, and we had to kind of bring them along and include them ongoing time. And we were using concepts like stacking and relative location throughout the project. So we organised this meeting before we knew that we had the funding for it. So we thought, well, we'll have it somewhere where most people are going to be anyway. We'll tag it onto the end of the convergence. And that means if we don't get the funding, well, we can have a meeting and discuss what to do next. And if we do get the funding, it pays for everyone's travel to come to the EUPC. Brilliant. So we've got the funding. There were some design dilemmas, so some people were very cautious or suspicious about setting up a structure which was heavily dependent on funding from the EU. Is this actually a sustainable structure or not? That's a really valid concern. I'd always anticipated that this would be like a big injection of energy and capital into the network that could then get things established. And I think it's worked to some extent, not entirely, but it's definitely possible. There were more, well, sort of same meeting. There were discussions about whether we should, about travel and whether we should be flying, and all the kind of things we've probably been thinking about, and we went to this event as well. We tried to build in a redistribution of surplus. So the countries in dark green got funding, and the countries in light green, which is basically Italy and Latvia, they applied for the funding and didn't get it. And then there are other countries like Ukraine who were able to come to one of the meetings, I think. And we were able to subsidise those to an extent by lowering the price for the unfunded participants. So it was a way of amplifying the impact of the funding that we got by kind of cross-subsidising within the network. There's a picture of Jan talking about the diploma. So each of these meetings was multifunctional in that we had all these different objectives, and each meeting would focus on one of those objectives but also attend to some of the others to give them some focus as well. We had this meeting in Portugal where things. This is where I learned about group theory, this kind of forming, norming, storming, whatever it is. In Portugal was definitely where all the storming happened. And I think we've been thinking, oh yeah, we'll all go to Portugal in the winter and have a nice bit of winter sun and wonderful, and everyone will be back there. We got there and just spent a week just kind of getting quite uptight and
we've kind of gone out of time, but I think it's about happening for Joe to actually have a few more minutes. This is really Christmas. I don't know, is that? I'd play with everyone.
Yeah.
I'll keep talking and keep listening. So yeah, it's like I likened it to the difficult third album that bands have, you know. Yeah, all kind of this viable systems model thing that we set up didn't quite work. People didn't know, different teams weren't talking to each other, people didn't know what they were supposed to be doing, people weren't feeling supported by other groups. At the same time, we've been implementing the viable systems model at the Permaculture Association in Britain. So I've been learning all about it, and I thought I knew the answers to all the problems. I knew all the answers. Yeah, I had all the answers. So I told everyone. This is what should be up. And that's when things really went wrong. So this is probably my biggest learning throughout the whole process.
I'm a little bit more arrogant than I thought.
And just the importance of spending time talking to people and listening and really communicating. Sometimes trying to show strong leadership just creates problems. So
here is Helena, Captain, and Tycho. And this is a curriculum survey that we did on what should be in a PVC. It's massive. So yeah, cover that in 72 hours. So this, basically we're into this, like, the implementation phase. These are the meetings up and running. We're talking about this kind of stuff. Should we even try and harmonise the European curriculum? These were the kind of questions that came out. This is some of my reflections on it. I got wrong. Then we had a kind of meeting in the UK, it was kind of healing meeting. We all kind of had a lot of time, it was all nice and fun. Then went to Spain, talked about how we're going to write all this up and share it. And you might have seen in the bar there's a brochure, EPT brochure thing that's on one of the tables, which is what the output of, or one of the outputs of the project. The teacher's handbook ended up going online, but we also produced this brochure. This is our organisational model based on inspired systems. Then my meeting I didn't go to, so I can't really tell you much about that. And the final meeting was in Bulgaria at the European Permaculture Convergence Fair. So the fact that the funding was going to pay for a meeting in Bulgaria meant that Bulgaria could then host an EPC, otherwise they probably would never be able to do it. That was the first PVC happened in Bulgaria as part of the sort of EUPC pattern. And from that has emerged the Bulgarian Permaculture Organisation. So it's really kind of, it has been a catalyst for lots of development across Europe, the Permaculture Organisation, Permaculture teachers. So in that sense, it's been really successful. This means Sandra doing a six hats evaluation. We could only manage three each. And so we did like a whole kind of consultation thought bit. And these are kind of, this is the plus minus interest in each country. So what was useful and what wasn't. You're probably not going to be able to read all that from there. The plus minus interesting. Here's how it relates to the ethics principles. This amazing finally, everyone kind of gave us, all the members gave us their feedback. I'm not embarrassing what you wrote. Show everyone else what you wrote, but I'll post it permanently. And then these are kind of reflections that went into our final report to the European Union. Which you're welcome to look online. Some personal reflections. I wrote a blog afterwards that created a little bit of discussion around teaching practice. So it went well, it was just a phenomenally successful project on many levels. It's really connected to the European Central scene. There's a new Finnish and Bulgarian national organisation. This kind of this continental family has emerged that we've created some really strong friendships as part of this process. Everyone's learned a lot of stuff, and it's created some economic activity, so there are more work networking opportunities as well, so it's helping to promote the permaculture economy across Europe as well. What was challenging? Diversity, working across different languages and cultural expectations about how you should behave in meetings, how structured should you be, should you be task focused or relationship focused, should you be dancing and singing every night, or should you be planning what you do tomorrow, and that kind of stuff. And the complexity of such a project was a real challenge. And the fact that we didn't have a paid worker, so it was all done voluntarily, like a whole project coordination. that's just some minor corrections. And then the next step was to come to the IPC meet up again. There have been European network discussions that have been going on as part of this. And then there's the next EUPC in Italy next year, so there'll be more kind of networking connections there. So yeah, it's been great. Lots of fun. And it's kind of continuing. So that's the EPT design. I'm horribly over. So it just remains for me to give a few thanks, really. Get a bit emotional. I've realised now I'm Andy Goldring because he suggested I do the diploma. And he also offered to pay for it as well. It's kind of part of my staff development with working with the association. But then they went and changed the system and it sort of doubled in price and they wouldn't pay for the rest. But yeah, Andy's been like a real mentor and inspiration on my Permaculture journey. Angus Souter did my induction event and had Chris Chidlow as his apprentice at the time. And Susie Hyde was also my tutor for a couple of years in the middle of my diploma. And finally, Graham Burnett has helped to get me over the finish line. So I've had four tutors on my diploma, which in some ways has been great because it's made lots of different people I've been able to learn from. I've been really lucky that because I work at the association, I'm really well connected to all the people in the network. So there's no way I can kind of include everyone, but other people who've been incredible sort of mentors and supporters would be Hannah Thorogood, Jan Mulgreeney, Chris Edwards, Arania, LAD members who've been wonderful. Thank you for letting me join your project and move in with it. Sandra's been an incredible collaborator and been a wonderful kind of friend, and also finally, thanks to Celia, has just been just a kind of amazing ball of wonderfulness. Thank you all.